became a development district in 1985 through the Economic Development Administration, and then we were codified by state statutes as a development district in 1992. So we've been around actually doing business since 1972. We, of course, serve the 11 counties of the Nebraska Panhandle. I have been with PAD for 19 years, going on my 20th year. Just to kind of give you a brief overview, I sent some stuff to Cindy to put into your packets. Kind of our fiscal year 2017 report that was put together by Daniel Bennett from our office. When I took over as executive director, one of the things that I felt was important to do was to get out to all of as many communities as we could. Of course, we cover 11 counties in the Panhandle, 43 some communities. But due to some staffing issues, we hadn't been able to do that for the past few years. So this past year, we were able to contact or work in, I shouldn't say work in, but contact 37 of the 45 communities that we serve. We got into all but three counties, or I should say two counties, Banner and Box Butte. In fiscal year 2017, we collected $56,583 in dues. We are still, in order to make up, if everyone joins, we're about $10,600 short. The reason that's important is that the EDA provides us with what's called a partnership planning grant every year for a three-year term. Last year, it was $66,000. This year, for this fiscal year, it's gone up to $70,000. Next year, it's looking like it'll go back to $66,000. And as you may know, there's a lot of agencies, federal agencies, that are under close scrutiny by the Trump administration. One of them is the EDA, and another program that is also being looked at very closely, among others, is the Community Development Block Grant Program. So, but the reason that that's important is the member dues that we collect have to, we have to match that EDA planning grant dollar for dollar. So we have to match that $70,000 this year. We try to do that as much as we can through our memberships. If we don't, if we aren't able to do that, we have to dip into our reserves. So the past few years we have had to dip into our reserves. We will probably have to do that this year, because if everybody joins, we're only about a little over $67,000. So this past year, one of the things that I wanted to do that we accomplished was have a board training session for our board members that are new or maybe been on the PAD board for a long time, just to kind of give them a general overview of what PAD is. We put together a membership or a manual for them that they could keep with them and pass on to their replacement if they're not designated for to be on the PAD board. We hope to continue that, if not every year, every other year. We formed a membership committee, and we also formed a Brownfields Coalition this past year as a result of some funding that we received. As far as membership goes, we looked at our dues structure. We hadn't done that for a long time. We completed that in February of this year and reviewed what is and what is not included in your memberships. One of the things we had hoped to try to do was establish a private membership structure with local businesses to try and get them on board. Due to staffing concerns, once again, we were not able to complete that. We're hoping to get that done in this next fiscal year and bring some associate members on board. One of the things that we do as part of getting the funds from the Economic Development Administration is we have to complete what's called a comprehensive economic development strategy for our area. We do have to do a new one every 5 years. We have to update that every year, which we do. And as part of that, we form committees to do workshops in conjunction. And this year, we're working with the community health improvement planning process. As far as our, one of the big things that we did this past year was we worked with a lot of communities with regards to brownfields. We worked in about 15 communities developing inventories in each of those communities of brownfields in their communities for possible redevelopment. And as you'll see later in the report, we recently received $445,000 from the EPA to take the next step in that process, which is to go ahead and go in and do the testing on those brownfield sites. Of course, Pat, Daniel Bennett in our office, part of his time is designated to help out with Heartland Expressway Association, and Daniel helped with the 2017 annual report and was very key in having the annual meeting that was held this past Friday in Alliance. And the Heartland Expressway has also added private memberships through the work of the board and members in local communities. And of course, the Western Nebraska Tourism Coalition was started by Pat back in 1998, and we provide bookkeeping support for the WNTC. And what started out as a organization to just get all of the tourism concerns in the panhandle, speaking as one, is now expanded east as far as North Platte. One of the things that we have started to do, we're acting as a technical assistance for communities to become certified leadership communities. As of right now, there's two. Bayard is working on theirs, Hemmingford has gotten theirs, and we are on board to be able to help those communities get that designation.
And with that allows them to apply for different funding sources yeah. that they don't have now, correct?
Right. Okay. Mm. Quick rundown of some of the community development things we've done. We helped Hay Springs complete their comprehensive plan. We completed blight studies in both Gordon and Hay Springs. We completed an income survey in Bayard. We're currently working with Mitchell to complete their income survey, and we will begin here before too long with Gordon. Some other studies and reports that we put together this past year, we did a Housing Authority market study for the Sydney Housing Authority. We helped Bayard update their comp plan. We worked with the Regional Public Health and Social Impact Factors Report, and we also assisted Regional West with some social and economic development factors that they had requested. We did a lot more this past year with workshops and trainings. We did one that dealt with environmental workforce development. Probably the two big ones we did this past year was a planning and zoning workshop that was made available to new county commissioners, new city council members. We had 43 people attend that. And then for the second year, I shouldn't say second year in a row, but for the second time, we had our social enterprise conference in June of this year that was attended by over 50 people. So we've gotten out and trained about 100 people this past year. Some of the grants that were obtained with the assistance from Pat, of course, the comprehensive development grant that the city got for $30,000. We administered that grant, and that grant is ready to be closed out. So we can get that done, but I'll get that to you. We wrote the CDBG grant for Tarrytown for the phase one of their water project. They're going to hook into the Gearing water for that. We helped Sydney with an economic development grant, worked on that, and they were working through our NDO, our nonprofit development organization, Panhandle Regional Development. Out of the $1 million they received, $200,000 of that is being paid back as a loan into Panhandle Regional Development, and that money can then again be loaned again once that is all paid off. We helped out the Village of White Clay with a demolition project through the assistance of the Department of Health and Human Services, and as I mentioned before, the Brownfields Coalition Assessment Grant of $445,000, so about over $1 million in grants in fiscal year 17. One of the things that Pat has under our business assistance is our Economic Development Loan Fund. Right now we have 15 outstanding loans with a total balance of over $500,000. In those 15 outstanding loans, the 186 total jobs have been created. In the last quarter, we had eight inquiries for new loans. Over the entire fiscal year, we had 21. Out of that, we only were able to issue two new loans. And in the fourth quarter, we did not have any total new loans. But in the fiscal year of 2017, We did do $200,000, and that was the loan for the economic development project. And two loans. One was in Gearing, and the other one was in Bridgeport. And as a result of that, 7 jobs were created. That's kind of all I had. I don't know if the council had any questions of me.
Now, one of the benefits of being associated with PAD is the ability to obtain different loans that the cities or villages in and of themselves couldn't do, correct?
Right.
So that's a lot what the memberships go for, is to be able to tap into some of those resources.
Yes.
Use your expertise for those.
Yeah. And another thing I didn't mention in the report is we did hire our economic development loan fund manager, Brian Venable. We hired him in October of last year, and he's just done an outstanding job with going out and soliciting new loans, working with people that apply for those loans, and making some very difficult decisions whether we're going to fund them or not. And we also had some loans that have been on the books for quite a long time that had fallen by the wayside that we've had to get caught up, which he's done a good job in doing. And of course, our social enterprise loan fund, which was part of the social enterprise conference. Social enterprise end of it, it's a business, but it has a social component to it. The best example that I always give is the Blue Star Recycling. Their business plan is to recycle computers. The social part of it is that they hire young adults and kids that are somewhere on the autism spectrum. This hasn't really caught hold yet. We're hoping, we've had a couple of inquiries and we're still working those through. So hopefully we'll be able to have some success stories with the Social Enterprise Fund too. So, mm-hmm.
So how much of what you do is government related and how much of it is private businesses?
Probably more of it is government related, working with all the communities doing things like comprehensive plans and zoning ordinances and nuisance abatement and blight studies and writing grants and administering those grants if they're community development grants.
Are private businesses members as well, or is it just?
We're looking at that. Their Northeast Development District in Norfolk, Nebraska has an associate membership program which we looked at. And the reason we looked at that was because, as I mentioned before, we have to match our EDA grant dollar for dollar. So we have to find, if we don't match that through memberships, we have to dip into our reserves to possibly do that. Through this associate membership program, which we're still kind of trying to work through, Northeast Nebraska has realized an additional $13,000 in revenue from their associate membership program. So
then when you do things for private businesses, do you get a fee for that, or do you just do it? I mean, like you said, you mentioned you did stuff for Regional West.
Yeah, we usually sign some type of professional services agreement not to exceed on kind of a, our member rate is $60 an hour. Our non-member rate is $100 an hour. So we charged Regional West at our non-member rate of $100 an hour.
So that's a way to get some extra revenue in.
Yeah, and those are,
okay.
Those.
I mean, I'm sure it's not a common thing. But
no, it was something that those things pop up out of the blue every so often, but you know, that's part of why we're here. So.
But you are available for businesses,
yes,
if they need that. That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right. Any other questions?
We could have used the Heartland Express all the way through today.
Yeah, think.
I was coming back from Gearing, watching it, and I went north on 71. It was just bumper to bumper going south, and every other car was Colorado. Mm-hmm.
It would have been nice if we could have made all 4 lanes,
yeah,
one way in and one way out.
All right, Jeff, thank you so much.
All right,
thanks.
Thank you.
I have a comment before you go, Jeff.
Oh,
I just want to express my appreciation to groups like yours, Michelle and the WNED, STAR, and what you're going to be doing. I've got 4 kids, a grandson, another one on the way. I want them to come back and stay here. The ones that are here, I want them to stay here. I want my son in college to come back here, find a job, and you guys are important in doing that. I appreciate that.
Well, and like you say, you know, PAD helps out with WNED. We're happy to help, you know, the city of Scottsbluff, all of our members, non-members, as much as we can, but I think that's kind of what it has to be. It can't be one group over here, one group over here, one group over here, and everybody's trying to do the same thing. It's just for a matter of survival, we all have to continue to work together. So, did you want me to talk about the RC&D? Okay.
We'll bring you back next week.
All right, it's 16 public comment. Is anybody under public comment?
I already did my thank you tour last Tuesday. We need to sign again.
You almost took it.
Actually, oh, please don't. Just to tag on to what you said, I'm doing the Baird Mayor hat now, and I know I've mentioned it to other meetings that I've been to, but I really wanted to, while I have your full council here, express my gratitude and your assistance to our community. And Randy, my God, you were a godsend. Monday night when we were moving, we needed vans to get people out of the nursing home and get them relocated. And your expertise, not only with just the connection from the community, but from your paying job, really came in handy. And it's that connectivity in the panhandle that really we got a huge benefit from. And I truly cannot exaggerate when I say I made not one phone call. It was people reaching out to me, what can we do to help? We're there. Both Nathan and other representatives from the other communities were there. Scottsbluff County was in my face in a very positive way. Tuesday morning on site at my fire department saying, what can we do to help? We can't come in and do this because you're not Scottsbluff County, but you know, we're right over, he said it several times, we're right over there. You know where we are, you know how to get a hold of me. And that said so much to my community. To be able to do that and to not have to think about that and have it taken care of. And by the end of the week, we had about 6 properties that we didn't have power restored to, and most of that was because they were waiting on electricians to fix a meter mast or something that really was out of our control. But knowing that your staff and your employees that assisted with that, I can't express enough how much that means. And again, organizations and communities working together in that format and making that connection and getting the Friday night football thing out the door when it really counts makes a big difference. And I think we showed the other end of the state how we can do it, and I think we just need to keep it up. Thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, council reports.
I just wanted to say with the beginning of the school year, there's been a vast improvement Longfellow School anywhere as far as this traffic study. I know it's only been a couple days, but I really appreciate that. Got the information in a very timely manner. I don't know how Second Avenue is doing. I know St. Agnes and the middle school had a little water main issue, but I was just wondering if there was something just to get some more feedback on positive remarks or if there's anything better or one-way traffic and things like that. That's all I was.
We typically don't get comments unless it's negative.
Darn it.
We don't know how to respond, I'm sorry.
But thank you. Mark and his crew painted that the other week, and we also put out signs in front of the high school. However, they've been run over several times.
I was like, so driver's ed, is that going to be the end of the year?
Yeah, it was there for a day.
Yeah, it was. When school first opened, it was really cool looking.
Okay, council reports.
Yeah, there's the other end, yeah.
Council reports. All right, seeing no other activities come before the council, ask for a motion to adjourn.
Yeah, so moved, whatever and stuff.
Second.
Call the roll.
Gonzalez?
Yes.
Caldwell?
Yes.
Meininger?
Yes.
Chaver?
Yes.
McCarthy?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Hey, what time are you going to the meeting?
12.
I heard it reboot, and I'm going, yeah, it didn't make it.
And it just, like, sure.
Want me to send you a copy of that?
Yeah, no.
Okay.
Mine did.
So you want to just do a presentation?
Same thing. She'll have a number.
Oh,
probably
yeah,
be tomorrow.
Yeah.
Doing the presentation.
Okay, like, all right. Thank you, Michelle. I appreciate it.
And he said some of that may be done.
I'm asking.
Yeah, not yet. I will tomorrow. That's what I do.
Yeah.
I'll get the ordinance number, and then I'd be happy to send you a copy of it. I have your email address.
Let me know if your plans change.
Okay.
I will.
Where the driving cap.
Right, and actually it's, yeah, well, the only thing that's gonna be changed, oh, okay, there is a, the proper address.
Well, it's all.
Date on there.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
So it's just.
And do we need any of these?
Okay.
I'm tired of this one. As far as I know, we just need this.
Number, okay, I can get you that.
I can't know if that is all we need to assume.
Okay, okay, and generally, you know, I get the mayor, after I print, I have to print this on fancy little paper and everything, and then the mayor will sign it.
Yeah.
And then, so I can give you a copy of the entire, you know, sign thing, but I can definitely get you the ordinance number tomorrow, okay? Yep, no problem.